I don't guess this is plugged up. All right. Pray I can see my notes. I'm not like my son. He said, Daddy, do you want that pulpit in there? I said, I sure do. I said, I got something to hold on to. While he's looking at this light, I want us to be in prayer for Jonathan and Kim today. He closes out his camp meeting in Southern Illinois. I wanted to be there with him and hear him. He said, Daddy, you hear me now every Sunday. And I said, yeah, but I want to hear you there and where I was raised up. He said, you just want to feel proud while I'm up there. He said, you don't need to do that. I need you to preach. I said, call Brother Tom. He'll do it. He said, Daddy, I want you to do it this Sunday. I said, okay, son. And so here I am. But it's always a privilege to stand up for the Lord. I said, maybe I need this to get my appetite whetted for the revival I'm going to hold in Vinemont Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. So you pray for me this weekend as I go there. It's their 105th anniversary as a congregation. So they've been in existence about as long as we have. And we want to pray that God will bless the Vinemont congregation. I want you to turn with me to a very familiar passage. Really, to be honest, what gave me the thought for this sermon was the sign at Concord Baptist Church. I was driving by and it had on there Philippians 4:13. I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. And I got to thinking about that. And I said, you know, Lord, that's probably the key words of the Christian life. It's the key words for any congregation. Young people, listen again. It says, I can do all things. I can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth me. That means any problem you're facing, Jesus has a solution for it. Amen? Anything the church sets out to do, Jesus will give us the power to do it. Anything He wants us to accomplish in our daily lives and ministry, we can do it through Him. There couldn't be more important words in Scripture than I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. I want you to listen to this passage of Scripture, beginning at verse 9 in Philippians 4. He said, those things, now notice what Paul says to the church at Philippi, those things which you have both learned and received and heard and seen in me, do. I thought, Lord, that's a powerful testimony. That means to the congregation I had the privilege of pastoring 20 total years, what you've received, what you've learned, what you've heard. And then it says, and I thought, Lord, can I say that? What you've seen in me, do, and the God of peace shall be with you. That's what Paul said. And the God of all peace, he said, will be with you. But I received in the Lord greatly that now at the last your great care of me hath flourished again, wherein you were also careful, but you lacked opportunity. Not that I speak in respect of want, for I've learned in whatsoever state I am therewith to be content. I quoted that a lot when I went to Springfield, Illinois. I moved from the great state of Alabama to the state of Illinois, and I read this often, whatever state I'm in. Of course, he's talking about circumstances. He said, I will rejoice and be content. I know both how to be abased and I know how to abound. Everywhere and in everything I'm instructed both to be full, to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. I can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth me. I want us to pray this morning before we get into our message. And as we enter into prayer, it's such a joy this morning to have all of you here, but It's especially good to see Betty and her husband, Jimmy, Thomas, is that right? And we're so glad to have them here today. Perry Ann, it just blessed me so much to see you here this morning. And I pray God will satisfy both needs that you mentioned this morning, your family's need and your need. It's good to see all of you. And I know we all come here with needs. I know I do. But I know God is the author and finisher of my faith. Let's pray together. Lord, as we stand in your presence today, God, it doesn't matter who's behind the sacred desk. What matters is that you're here and that your Holy Spirit is blessing the Word of God that you've laid upon the spokesman's heart. So, Father, we're trusting in the anointing of the Holy Spirit to rest upon each individual here, each family here. Lord, upon me, upon Sister Absher, she's teaching children's church this morning. Oh, God, may your presence touch the lives of our children, our young people, the young adults, middle-aged, older folk. Lord, we need the touch of your hand upon us. We need to be reminded that we can do anything you ask us to do through the power of the Holy Spirit. So speak to us afresh and anew. Bless Jonathan as he's sharing the word today there in Southern Illinois camp meeting. Give a great outpouring as well. And we'll praise and thank you for every victory. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, I was reminded all over again when Samuel came along how important the words of little children are. I got so tickled at Matt and Hannah. Here's Matt, college degree, Hannah, college degree, and they're down there at that little baby saying, "Mama, mama, mama." And then Matt will say, "No, dad, 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 dad." It tickled me so much when he said, "Papa." Bree came over and watched the babies, or Jonathan's three children. Elijah's certainly not a baby, and neither is Bella, but Luke is. And Jonathan said, "Mom, I need you at 4 a.m. to be there with the kids. They'll still be sleeping while I take Kim to the hospital for her procedure." Marie said, "Honey, are you going?" I said, "4 a.m. it is." She said, "Yes." I said, "I'm staying home." She said, "Okay." So I heard her leave, but I was still in bed sleeping. And about 8 o'clock, the phone rang, and I was in the easy chair having a cup of coffee. And she said, "Honey, are you busy?" I said, "No, I'm just sitting here in my chair having a cup of coffee." She said, "Honey, little Luke is going from room to room saying, 'Papa, Papa.'" Said, "Please come over." So I said, "I will." So I dressed and went over there. And when I came through the door, he said, "Papa." And he came, put his arms around my leg. You know, words mean so much to us, do they not? Especially the words of little children. John and his wife told me this morning that the member of their class wasn't here. And that's Bella. And so they came down and said, "Boy, Brother Absher, she's a joy to teach." I said, "Well, great." Said, "We were telling the other day when your mother was here," said, "did you know that's your pawpaw's mother?" She said, "No, it's not. It's my dad's grandmother." Oh, man. Words are so important to us. On the other hand, I've always been interested, you might think this is funny, but I've been interested in the last words of people and epitaphs, and I've read a lot of them and looked at them. One of them that I'll never forget, there was this man that had on his tombstone in Southern Illinois, he said, "Here lies one who did his best in hopes that he will pass the judgment test." I thought, well, that's comical and got a good ring to it, but it's not theologically correct. What's going to cause us to pass the judgment test is not what we write on our tombstone, but it's our total faith in Jesus Christ as our Savior and Lord. If Brother Absher makes it to heaven, it's because of Jesus and what he's done for me. It's because of the victory he gave me when he wiped my slate clean and forgave me and then gave me the birth of the Spirit of God to help me do what I couldn't do before. And then the fullness of his Spirit that came as I grew in Christ and conformed to his image, and the power to evangelize and share Jesus with other people. Wow! Jesus is the only reason any of us will go to heaven. I thought of the seven last words of Jesus Christ on the cross. I don't know if you remember, I preached a series on that one Easter. I thirst. Jesus, who created the world and water itself, cried from the cross because of his humanity, I thirst. He said to John, the beloved disciple, behold your mother, and mother, behold your son, being sure she was provided for at his death. He also said, this day to the thief on the cross, you shall be with me in paradise. The thief. No time to go to church, no time to pray or read any scripture, no time to join any religious institution, no time to be baptized. And he said, this day, because of your faith in me, you shall be with me in paradise. And then he prayed, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. He said then, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? God forsaken of God, the paradox of Scripture. And then he cried from the cross, into thy hands I commend my spirit. And then he said, in a shout, like a conquering warrior, it is finished. Praise God, redemption had been brought to humanity through his death on the cross and his glorious resurrection from the tomb. All kinds of sermons, all kinds of musical productions have been written because of these seven word statements of our Lord Jesus Christ. Since Jonathan's come and things are changing, and by the way, I feel with all my heart for the better. As your pastor 20 years, I want to take away any question or any kind of thing that may be in your mind. I believe with all my heart what's happening is for the better of Rock Creek Church of God. I love to see him up here, no pulpit, moving about freely to preach the word without note. I love the Spirit's anointing upon him. And I love changes that are taking place in the life of our church. I guess some of the words that I thought of that are most destructive to the body of Christ through the ages are the words, we never did it that way before. We never did it that way before. But I thought of our lives. It doesn't reflect in our home. We want better automobiles, shinier, brighter, more gadgets. We want the latest cell phone and we want all the technological advantages. We want, I was telling VC what I was planning to preach today. He said, we've got to have granite countertops now in our kitchen. Said it used to be linoleum stretched over wood. We can change everywhere. But if we change in the church, we get a little bit nervous about it. My friends, I want you to know, relax yourself. I'll be 70 in July and I'm ready for change. I want to see more young people, more children in the life of this church. I want to see this community reached. I've prayed for that for 20 years, and I believe it's going to happen. So let's embrace change for the good. Change on the Word of God. Change that can help reach others in our generation for Jesus Christ. It's not the same generation that I started preaching to in 1963. No, it's a whole different ballgame. And so let's pray that we will be willing to change. If these are the seven last words of the church, we never did it that way before. I want to share with you what should be the seven words that we embrace as a congregation today. I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. These are our text. They're a good summary statement of the Apostle Paul's life. Study his life. The greatest missionary that's ever lived. He did not have our means of transportation or communication or any of those things. Traveled by boat and walked. But he said as he met the challenges of his generation, I can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth me. These should be the words on which we as a congregation and we as individuals in the life of the church base our life and our ministry. We can do all things, praise God. And I believe that with all my heart. Please notice that these words of the church are positive words. Paul said, I can. It's amazing when you and I consider that Paul said, I can do all things through Christ, when we consider his circumstances. Paul was in prison. He was in chains. And yet he wrote to the church in that kind of situation when some of us may be saying, Lord, why me? I've been preaching for you, teaching for you, and now the Roman guards put me in bonds and I'm in prison. Paul said, I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. And bless your heart, some of the Roman guard became Christian while Paul was in that prison cell. And eventually, 300 years later, the Roman Empire embraced Christianity as the only religion. We can do all things. When it seems impossible, there's victory at the door. I'm amazed at how easy it is to say, I can't do it. Have you ever said it? I have. I cannot do it. I just can't. Have you ever said that? No one's ever said that but me. You know, Mom's dad couldn't stand for you to say, I can't. He had a third grade education. He couldn't read or write. He built Oklahoma State Baptist University in Shawnee, Oklahoma, every building. He could go out to a job site and see the dimensions and tell you how many brick and how many block to order, and he wouldn't miss it. But Grandpa never said, I can't. He said, I can. And if you ever said it, and I said it to him when I was a young man, Grandpa, I can't do that. He'd look at me and he'd never get mad or raise his voice, but he'd grit those false teeth so loud that you wanted to run and hide. You could hear him grinding. Son, don't say you can't. You can. Try it. You can do it. I've had people tell me in the church, Brother Absher, there's one part of the Christian life I just can't live. I said, what do you mean? I cannot control my temper. I've tried and tried, but I fail miserably. My friends, I want you to know that God, through His Holy Spirit, can help you control your temper. Amen? He can help you control your temper. Other people say, Brother Abner, I have bad thoughts. Had a man tell me that the other day. I've got bad thoughts and I know I'm sinning. I said, no, the bad thought's not the sin. It's not? I said, no. It becomes a sin when you do it. He said, what do you mean, preacher? And I said, well, Mama always told me, son, you're not going to keep birds from flying over your head, but you can sure stop them from building a nest in your hair. I said, with every temptation, God will make a way of escape, praise God. We don't have to sin. I know that a lot of people like to say today, well, we all sin. Sin we must or we'll bust, you know, but I don't believe that. I think sin is a possibility. Or 1 John 2 wouldn't have been written, these things I write to you that you sin not, an aorist tense, which means that you don't even commit an act of sin. That's God's intention. But if you do, you have an advocate with the Father. Sin should not be a regular thing in the life of the believer. Why? Because the Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead lives within us. He can help us to live a holy life. Get up out of the mire of sinning daily and live on the victorious plateau of knowing holiness in your life and purity of heart and of mind. People say, I can't stand my job. Well, I don't know if you've got one. You ought to be happy today. Amen. You ought to be happy. I never had a job that I disliked. I had some I liked better than the other, but every one of them, I thank God for the job He'd given me. I thank God for the privilege to get up and go to work. I started out as just a young boy throwing newspapers and mowing yards when I was in the seventh grade. Bought my first bicycle that way. Walked wherever I went pushing that lawnmower in a gas can. Mowed 17 yards every summer in Benton, Illinois. Was it hard work? Yes, it was. Did it help me? I guess it did. I'm still living. I lay this diabetes on Sister Abshire. She's prayed for 50 years that God would make me a sweeter man. He's overdone it in my old age. I can't tell you the Christians have told me I can't tithe. There's some here that told me that years ago. And when they started tithing, God has turned a picture of blessing upon them. And He still does today. You can't outgive God. Every Christian ought to be a tithing believer and ought to give as God prospers you. Another person's told me, I can't teach Sunday school class. Have you ever tried it? Some of the greatest teachers I've known were timid people, shy people, but when they submitted to a leadership role, the Holy Spirit just blessed them in such a wonderful way. Jonathan used to tell me when he was a young man, Daddy, I could never get up there and preach like that. I'm too shy. I said, honey, if God wants you to do it, He'll use your personality in a way He can't use anyone else. And He has. People say, I can't pray in public. If you can pray in private, you can pray in public. You're not doing it for those in the crowd. You're doing it because you're talking to Jesus. Amen. People say, I can't witness. Oh, yes, you can. I've seen Christians who've told me that become some of the greatest soul winners in the life of the church. It's so natural for me now at age almost 70 that I don't care where I am, whom I'm talking to, we get around to Jesus. Why? Because He's the most important thing in my life. He's the most important thing in their life. They just don't know it yet. I don't know how many Christians say to me, Brother Abshire, I can't live a holy life. I'm glad I've got an advocate. I said, I'm glad you've got an advocate. I'm glad I have, but you can live a holy life. Peter said of us that we're saints of God. We're not sinners. We're saints. We were sinners, but we're saints of God. We're a royal priesthood. We're a peculiar people. We're different from the world. We love the world because we all walk that way. But brother, listen, Jesus makes a difference in our lives. Instead of the negative, I can't, please today covenant with the Lord, I can. Remember, someone else is living this way. Other Christians are enjoying the victory where we're realizing defeat. Why? Because they've learned to rely on the Holy Spirit of God. They've learned to walk in His fullness daily. They've learned whenever they fail Him to confess it immediately to God. If they fail before someone else, ask their forgiveness. Put to death the deed of the flesh by the Holy Spirit. Get up and live in holiness. As a church, we should not major on what we don't have in the way of budgets or buildings or location. We should focus on what we do have in the way of people, programs, and possibilities. There's enough power right here in this youth group to change our society for Jesus Christ. You said, Brother Epcher, be careful. There he is. There's more than 12 of them here. Jesus took 12 men and changed the then known world. Fishermen, most of them, changed the world. Yes, we can do it. Amen, Rock Creek. Secondly, these words suggest a pattern that you and I should follow. Paul said, I can do all things. You mean we can treat our wives the way the Bible teaches us to treat them? It says we can do all things. Husbands, you can treat your husband like the... All things. Parents treat children like they ought to be treated. All things. Children, obey your parents. All things. Live a holy life. All things. You see, Paul, when he said, I can do all things against the tide of public opinion or endorsement of the right people in society, he set out to do all things for Jesus Christ. Don't be overwhelmed by how much there is to do. As a young pastor, I used to be overwhelmed. My first prayer meeting night, I had one man, Harold Hagler, who came to Wednesday night Bible study. I said, Lord, how in the world am I going to build a church here in Carbondale? We left there 3 years later. Now, I was 19, Marie was 18. Don't tell her I told you her age. And 3 years between Anderson College and Gulf Coast Bible College, we built up a congregation of an average of 66 people. Bought new land on Giant City Blacktop where there stands a nice brick building now. All things are possible. As we start, please notice Paul's pattern for doing all things. He went to one place. He tackled one thing at a time. And then he'd move on to the next place. Can you say this morning as you leave here, I'm going to take one person or one family. I'm going to zero in on them this year. And I'm going to share Jesus. I'm going to love them. I'm going to meet their needs. I'm going to help them to embrace Christ through me. One person, one family? Can we all do that? Can we all, one person, one family? Can we all do that? Jesus followed this same pattern. He came to one place at one time, to one people, to bring salvation to the entire world. He committed world evangelization to 12 people. And one of them betrayed him. But look at Christendom in our world today. Young people, we can do it. I don't care who our president is. I don't care what the economic condition, the moral decadence of our society. We can do it through Christ. Amen? Jesus never asked us to do everything at once. He asked us to be faithful in something about reaching the world for Jesus Christ. Now finally, the words of this text affirm a presence in our lives. How is any of this done that Paul's challenging us to do? Paul said, I can do all things through Christ. When I went to Anderson to go to college when I was 16 years old, just about to turn 17, my mom and daddy had no money, no resource. I had a job in a bakery, had to be there at 4 a.m. and bake all the donuts and pastry until my first class at 7:30. And it was a Greek class. Had to work in the dining hall. And my job was all the big pans. Now, when you cook for a college, you've got big old pans that tall. I'm serious. And to wrestle those things, I was sure glad I'd mowed yards for a child up and carried brick for Grandpa and Daddy in order to get free meals. Left there with $10,000 indebtedness. Went 2 years. Took the church to help the state start a work in Carbondale. Then I went to Gulf Coast. And in 2 years, got my degree. In 4 years, I graduated. Worked 40 to 48 hours a week at the DAD plant in Houston, loading trucks every night. School started at 7:30. Got through at 3 o'clock. Had to be at work at 3:30. Now, that was every day except Saturday and Sunday. And I was preaching at League City, leading music for them, teaching Sunday school later for Dr. Leroy Ash at his church. Went in weighing 170 pounds, graduated weighing 126. Had a fatigue temperature every day for 6 months. But you know what? I quoted constantly, I can do it through Christ. I can do it through Christ. And by the way, I made it. Young people, we can do it. Amen? We can do it. It is Christ working through the individual that makes possible victorious Christian living and effective Christian ministry. I've shared this story before a long time ago, but it sure fits here. I was reading one day of an old farmer. And every morning before he went to his fields, he went to the church. And he spent 1 hour at the altar of his church, old country church. And then he'd go work all day. And before he went home, he'd go back to the church. He'd spend another hour at the altar. And people got to noticing that. And one day, one of the citizens said, Farmer, why do you go every morning and spend an hour at the altar praying? Why do you go every night after you're finished? And he said, what do you do? He said, I just look at Jesus, and he looks at me. I just look at Jesus, and he looks at me. Are we going to let Jesus look at us this morning? Are we going to let him show us wherever there are needs in our life? Are we going to let him have his way in our hearts and lives? I want to tell you something. There's nothing that Rock Creek Church of God can't do for Jesus. If we will spend time looking at him and letting him look at us. Let's stand together as we go to the Lord in our time of invitation. Brother Wayne, I want you to lead us in Have Thine Own Way, Lord. Have Thine Own Way. Would you do that? Please. be thinking about your life? I've thought a lot about mine. I told Jonathan the other day, I said, son, I've grown more spiritually in the few months you've been here than I have in a long time. I've learned some things I wish I knew, I had known when I started out. I told him, my boy, that, and he said, Daddy, if I lead the souls to Jesus you have, I'll be thrilled to death. I said, no, honey, I'm not talking about soul winning. I'm talking about nurturing the saints. Nurturing the saints. We need that, don't we? Don't we need that? I want to be a better man, a better dad, a better granddad than I've ever been. May not have long to do it, but what time I've got, I'm working on it. And I want us to be the best church that we've ever been before. You know what would thrill me is to see this place so grow that we had to meet in the Family Life Center. I mean that. So grow that we'd have to build a bigger building someplace. And I believe it can happen. I believe it can happen. If we simply say, I can do all things through Christ who strengtheneth me. Let's be done with lesser things and let's embrace God's will for our lives. Lead us, brother.